I chose for the introductory panel a quote from Johann Bodmer, a Swiss interpreter of William Shakespeare, and in 1741, he stated, "Imagination outstrips all the world's magicians. It not only places the real before our eyes in a vivid image and makes distant things present, but also, with a power more potent than that of magic, it draws that which does not exist out of the state of potentiality, gives it a semblance of reality, and makes us see, feel, and hear these new creations." Small Worlds came to me as an idea for a way to teach people another way of looking at art. We have occasionally people that come through the gallery expecting nothing more than pretty pictures. I wanted to assemble an exhibition where the artists are talking more about the world that surrounds them and the things within their imagination that inspire them to make their work. So what we have in the Small Worlds exhibition are not necessarily pretty pictures that would hang over the sofa, but interpretations that come from these individual artists. They're very beautifully crafted. All of the four artists in the show are quite versatile with the medium, which is offers a sort of a compelling work to look at. Once the audience is in front of the work and starts to examine it on the surface, hopefully they'll go deeper, take a look at what is inside of that picture, find familiar items, familiar situations, familiar objects, and in identifying them, say, well, you know, this is a small world, this is something I identify with, I'm familiar with what the artist intends here. Whether they know exactly what the artist was up to or not isn't really terribly important. What's important is that the audience is engaged and takes something away with them as a result of having stood in front of the art. Donna Balma lives in Roberts Creek in a small cabin with a bountiful garden. She works in this studio cabin with a stream of consciousness method. She's developed an inventory of images that are evident through most of her work. There are underground scenes, there are flying characters, images that defy gravity, mechanical birds, finger-shaped people, runners, and sometimes nuns or grand matronly figures. Thank you.
Lori-Ann Latremouille is a Vancouver artist who works almost exclusively in charcoal and pastel. Her image has come from her dreams. They literally are her dreams. She wakes up after having had a dream, does a sketch, and then works the sketch into a full-blown drawing. Interesting to note that Lori-Ann is self-taught and hasn't had any formal art education. Robert Chaplin lives in Vancouver. Interesting to know that he was at one time an artist working for the Disney Studios, but he's far too independent and creative to be locked into a factory mill like that. His works are all hand-carved. Nothing is cast, that is to say. He uses a high-speed electric drill with diamond bits. His works are narrative. They exist along with and are completed by his text, which fully described the piece. He uses semi-precious and sometimes precious material to work with, which he likes to point out is worth nothing until it's been rendered into an object by a crafts or artist person. Lindsay Craig has a very interesting take in her paintings. She uses oil paint on linen in a very traditional painting style. Her subject matter is, the sources come from popular culture, the popular icons, ritualized objects, stereotyping that sort of evolves within our culture through consumerism and how we appear, how we adorn ourselves, or how we are maybe expected to appear. She really delves into personal items, dolls, which certainly become fetishes or standards for women. Also, she talks about some of the mythologies that come out of popular culture, popular heroes, perhaps, famous painters, and significant landmark sites that may be lowbrow or of low culture, but because of their popularity, take on an extraordinary importance in our lives.